A hearty welcome to all of you on this auspicious occasion of our Independence Day. Honorable the Chief Justice of India, Sri T.S. Thakur, Honorable Judges of the Supreme Court of India, the guest of honor, the Minister of Law and Justice, Sri Ravi Shankar Prasad, who is himself a very active practitioner and a member of the bar and a leading practitioner before he was elevated as a Minister for Law and Justice. The learned Additional Solicitor General, Mr. Bhatia, our Secretary, members of the Executive and Office Bearers of Supreme Court Bar Association, members of SCBA, ladies and gentlemen, the Secretary General and the members of the Registry, the security people, thank you very much for arranging everything in a perfect manner. Today, we have assembled to celebrate the 70th year of our independence, a very auspicious and thanksgiving day for the citizens of our country, to all those who fought and gave their lives to secure independence for our country. On behalf of SCBA, I extend our heartiest congratulations, greetings and best wishes to each and every members of the bar, as well as each and every citizen of our country and the entire nation to join this celebration. The seed of greatness of our country lies in the history itself. After the First War of Independence in 1857 and after its aftermath, the formation of Indian National Congress in 1885 marked the beginning of a new era in the national movement. The British rule governed from 1600 to 1947 through the East India Company, viceroys, and governor generals with the help of charters and other enactments made by the British Parliament. Three important legislation is worth mentioning at this moment, which were made by the British Parliament, which had a bearing on making our constitution. And I would refer that. The first was making of Indian constitution with the Indian Council Act 1909, followed by the 1919 Government of India Act and Government of India Act 1935. On 9th of August 1942, the Quit India Movement was initiated under the able leadership of Mahatma Gandhi, and each and every member, young and old, literate and illiterate, rich and poor, who participated and sacrificed their lives to achieve the liberty and independence, participated, and what we see is today an independent India and a democratic India. As per the Cabinet Mission Plan of 1946, according to Viceroy Wavell, the plan was expected to be the blueprint for freedom. A Constituent Assembly was accordingly elected, and the first meeting of the Constituent Assembly was held on 19th of December 1946, which later adopted the Objective Resolution, which became the preamble of our Constitution. Mahatma Gandhi's inspiring statement is worth mentioning here. We shall either free India or die in the attempt. We shall not live to see the perpetuation of our slavery. With the enactment of Indian Independence Act on 18 July 1947, two independent dominions of India, unfortunately, India and Pakistan, were created with effect from 15th of August 1947. The Act also conferred full powers of the Constituent Assembly and to supersede the Indian Independence Act without any further requirement of any legislation from the British Parliament. Was enacted, adopted on 26th of November 1949, and the same commenced its operation and came into effect on 26th of January 1950. India became a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic with a parliamentary system of government. We owe a lot to our forefathers in making it possible to live in an independent India. Great minds have been born, and they nurtured not just this great land with their ideas, but have taken the whole world in their arms. India gave, a very important aspect of the matter, India gave zero to the numerals, to the entire world, without which the entire fulcrum of scientific development and otherwise would have been stalled. The great scientist Albert Einstein rightly said, "We owe a lot to the Indians who taught us how to count, without which no worthwhile scientific discovery could have been made." The German scholar Max Müller while paying glowing tributes to India, said, "If I were asked what sky the human mind has most fully developed, some of its choicest gifts, has most deeply pondered on the greatest problems of life, and has found solutions, I should point to India. Today we must remember and show gratitude to those who gave up their everything they had to achieve this great independence. As we all know, the role of legal fraternity, whether it was in the Indian independence movement or even at every point of time, was great and substantial. Be it Mahatma Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru, Bal Gangadhar Tilak, Lala Lajpat Rai, C. Raj Gopalachari, Deshbandhu C.R. Das, Saifuddin, Kichlew, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel and many more. The oppressive laws of British regime tried to suppress them by brutality of police force. People all over India faced this brutality with courage, conviction and dedication of the motherland and for future generations. The era was of moderates like Dadabhai Naroji, Surendranath Banerjee, Madan Mohan Malviya and Motilal Nehru. Amongst others who were also lawyers by profession, the moderates believed in the system of constitutionalism. They passed numerous resolutions on issues such as civil rights or opportunities in government, which were submitted to the viceroys and occasionally to the British Parliament. Lawyers like Bal Gangadhar Tilak, who was not a moderate, gave a new direction to the Indian National Congress. Tilak began a new phase of more radical thought within the organization. He put forth new ideas and methods of opposing the imperialist rule and advocate stronger actions like the boycott of foreign goods and the policy of Swadeshi, that is self-reliance. He did not believe that the British rule was beneficial and instead felt that their rule was extremely harmful. He introduced the idea of Swaraj, complete independence, way back in 1897 with his famous statement, "Swaraj is my birthright and I shall have it." Other eminent lawyers who supported the radical ideology were Bipin Chandra Pal and Lala Lajpat Rai, who were popularly known as Punjab Kesari, Sere Punjab. He formed the non-moderate wing of the Congress along with Tilak and Bipin Chandra Pal. The trio was popularly known as Lal, Bal and Pal. Later, Lajpat Rai presided over the first session of the All India Trade Union Congress in 1920. He also went to Geneva to attend the 8th International Labour Conference in 1926 as a representative of the Indian Labour Organization. His journals, Bande Mataram and People, contained his inspiring speeches to end oppression by the foreign rulers. The history of India has been spectacular all throughout. Right since the dawn of civilization, with Indian civilization being one of the oldest, it has been through a lot of thick and thin. India has seen the best of times and also has gone through some of the most challenging of times throughout its long trajectory. The recent past of it being under colonial rule has not been one of its best periods. One of the most appropriate depiction of it was written by none other than Dadabhai Naroji in his book, Poverty and Un-British Rule in India, where he put it, forward gradual and organized drain of Indian resources during the British colonial rule. Lawyers played a great role and great part in bringing political freedom to the country. With the selfless guidance and statesmanship of legal profession, the Indian National Movement gained participation and its impact reached far beyond immediate political consequence. Now lawyers shall play their part in bringing economic revolution in the country. Adam Smith said that economic factors are the prime movers in history. We shall see India play that role efficiently and deftly with the active assistance of legal fraternity, which includes not just the bar but also the bench. Indian judiciary has also played a pioneering role in the last two decades in assisting in its own way to the development of the country in every spheres of life, whether it is downtrodden or anyone else. Today, from this platform, when both the Honorable the Chief Justice of India and the Law Minister, Honorable the Law Minister, are present, there is an earnest request on behalf of the bar that any decision taken concerning the Supreme Court Bar Association and the members of the Bar Association, which is the apex body, at least they need to be consulted and at least their views should be taken into consideration. This is a humble request to both who are present here. The success of Indian democracy is one of the biggest achievements in human history in the recent past. It stands as a unique and positive example for its neighbors, as well as newly independent countries to experiment with democracy as a viable and rewarding political experiment. Right to freedom and equality and liberty is an entrenched fundamental right which is jealously protected by the honorable courts in India. The press and media have played a pioneering role in the guarding of our democracy and the rights of its citizens. Today we salute those soldiers of freedom movement because of whom we are able to preserve our liberty and sovereignty. Ladies and gentlemen, we should redeem our pledge, what our forefathers had done, and rededicate ourselves to achieve the hopes and aspirations of those who sacrificed their lives and freedom and make them feel proud of us. We specifically, the members of the bar and the bench, should take oath to help our country by contributing ourselves to wipe out the tears and fears from the eyes of every citizen of our country. With these words, I welcome you all in this celebration. Jai Hind.
Thank you, Mr. Ajit Sinha ji, for those inspiring words. May I now request Mr. P.S. Narasimha, Additional Solicitor General of India, to kindly address the gathering here on this august occasion. Can we have a round of applause, please?
Honorable Chief Justice of India, Honorable Minister for Law and Justice, Vice President Ajit Sinha, our Secretary Gaurav, and our Sandeep Singh. My pranams to all elders and best wishes to friends. 2016 Independence Day has become a rather memorable Independence Day for me. I wanted to share one experience in this unexpected occasion of addressing the gathering. Both my grandfathers were freedom fighters, so all my younger days were spent in hearing stories about freedom fighting all the time. So one day I asked my maternal grandfather, what's the point in you telling me the stories of those who gave up their life fighting for independence? He said something which moved and remained with me for the rest of the time. He said, if you are living without the memory of independence story and it doesn't form part of your lifeblood, then it is not worth living. From that day, I was so inspired. So I was on every occasion reading those who contributed towards independence. Like I was in Jharkhand the other day, the name of the airport is Birsa Munda Airport. The story of Birsa Munda is so inspiring. And many of us don't know about this. There are hundreds and thousands of such people who have inspired us and have led to the freedom movement, led the freedom movement, and we have achieved that. On that very occasion, there's another aspect of it, of this story. When my maternal grandfather also happened to be there, he said, it's not merely important to convert the story into your lifeblood, but it is far more important to remember it. He says, freedom movement has, and then the achievement of independence has become a symbol, and it will slowly deplete from the hearts of men if you don't keep on remembering it. The importance of symbol is that you must remember it, you must think about it, you must talk about it, and go on with and teach our children about it. Unless that happens, the importance of independence movement and then the sacrifices of our people will be forgotten in no time. This occasion and such occasions all over the country are of great importance to us, and we must participate in them, and we should also encourage our younger generation to come and participate and carry on the information of this oral history, as what they call. The independence movement is very much documented, but then the oral history part of it is equally important. That oral history must be recognized, and through the process of family and friends and association, it must be passed on. That's a small experience I wanted to share with you all. Thank you very much. I thank everybody of my patience.